people trying to join us on this live stream, but give us a few minutes and let people be able to find the webpage and the live stream, and we'll start here shortly. Still have people joining us, Phil? We still have people joining? Okay, so people are still coming in. I'm going to talk a little bit about some housekeeping. But first of all, we want to welcome everyone to grades 9 and 12 digital synchrony virtual learning orientation. This is our first one. We're actually live streaming it, and we will be taking questions through email. Just some housekeeping details we want to talk about. Tomorrow night at 6 p.m. we'll be doing the middle school and elementary program orientation. So you want to use the same app that you used today and same link in order to join us live. We are going to record this presentation. So if you want to go back and revisit the presentation, obviously you can do that through our website. Periodically, we will take questions on the PowerPoint. We have the actual email. Each slide on the PowerPoint tonight will have the email address. So if you want to ask us a question, you simply would go to dsl@nafcs.org and simply send your question, and we'll do our best to answer those questions tonight. So with that, I want to introduce several people in the room tonight. We have Mr. Duffy's in the room, who's our elementary director, Dr. Steve Griffin, who's the middle school assistant superintendent. And then also we have Ms. Michelle Free, who's our special ed director. Tonight, most of the work will be done by Mr. Wonky. Wonky serves as our DSL e-learning virtual coach. He's been working a lot of hours this summer with our teachers in preparation for our virtual learning platform. Kyle, go ahead and show. We want to point out something on our webpage. The PowerPoint is on our webpage tonight. Why don't you go ahead and show where that's located on our webpage. So if you simply go to the DSL Learning Orientation for grades 9 and 12, and you can hit the tab that says View High School Orientation, you'll see the PowerPoint if you want to follow along with us tonight. And that's how you activate the PowerPoint. We do know there's a lot of nervousness at the start of the school year, and tonight's orientation we hope that will help answer a lot of those questions. If you think about it, we're entering an unprecedented school year. This is the first year as myself as a school administrator to actually offer two learning options. We always have offered the traditional learning option where kids simply go to school in a physical setting and attend the seven classes. This year, because of COVID-19, we've had to offer a virtual program. We feel very confident that New Albany Floyd County Schools is going to provide you a platform educational value that will meet the expectations that everyone has in New Albany Floyd County Schools. And I think you'll find out that this virtual learning experience is totally different than what you saw in the spring. And we're going to kind of go through that in details. So with that, I think we got several sizable population joining on. So we'll go to the next slide and talk about the agenda tonight. As I said, we're here till all questions we can answer. We'll do our best to make sure people feel comfortable with this learning environment. We will basically explain what digital synchronous learning is. We refer to it as DSL in short. And it's totally different, as I said earlier, than we did in the spring. We'll actually go through a high school schedule. We'll talk about devices, the do's and don'ts with the devices, if something goes wrong with your device, and how you will deal with that. Student expectations. There's expectations for our students out there in virtual land that we want them to be able to fulfill what we would want in a classroom setting. Parent-teacher communication. We'll tell you parents on how to communicate with our teachers, and we also will show you where resources are on our webpage if you want to learn more about how to operate Google Classroom and Google Meet. What is digital synchronous learning or virtual learning environment? Basically, the students who enroll in this have the same rights as any student that attends our physical setting school. So if you're a student in our virtual program, you have the same rights as a person who's going to be attending our schools K-12. So if you want to participate in clubs, sports, or any of our performing art programs, you may participate in those. At any time during your virtual experience, if you'd like to go back to the physical setting, we would welcome you to come back to the physical setting. I will say this, the educators in New Albany Floyd County Schools really truly believe that being in the traditional setting, the physical setting of a school, better quality of education. However, we do realize that we have a lot of parents and students are very nervous about attending school again in that physical setting. So that's why we're offering this other opportunity. Students with IEPs, I'm going to ask Ms. Michelle Free, our Director of Special Education, to talk a little bit about that, what we will deal with our students who have an IEP.
As Dr. Jensen stated, it's unknown territory for us. So what we do believe is that we can provide the services that students need in the IEP. We likely, in most cases, will need to reconvene that conference and talk about the services that will be provided. We have the obligation to provide an appropriate education to your child that's reasonably calculated by the case conference committee. So we will be reaching out to parents who have chosen the virtual option to look at how we're going to provide the services that your child needs individually through the time that you participate in the virtual learning.
So Ms. Free, in essence, the teacher of record of the student will reach out within the first 10 days and have a conversation about what adaptations will be met and what the needs of the student. That's an expectation.
That's correct. And we're saying it will be within the first 10 days because obviously we need to get everybody in school. We need to get our classes started, help the students that are there physically to be acclimated. We don't want to pull teachers out to do case conferences the very first few days of school, but we absolutely expect that we will convene conferences and meet and help you understand what services will be provided during the virtual learning.
And just to clarify, a student who does have an IEP, the expectation is you do start the first day of school. You do not wait till the teacher record contacts you or you have your case conference meeting to determine your changes in your educational plan. So let's go to the next slide. Digital synchronous virtual learning experience. In essence, it's kind of what we're doing tonight. We have people out in what we refer to as virtual, looking on a live stream into this boardroom, and then we have people in the audience. And that's basically what your student's going to experience at the high school level, grades 9 through 12. Totally different than the spring. In the spring when we were doing e-learning, in essence what we were doing was teachers would periodically touch base with you during a period from 9 o'clock to 3 o'clock. We're not going to do that. You're basically, your student is going to be on the same bell schedule as if they were in a physical setting in the school. School starts at 7:40 and ends at 2:26. They will follow the same bell schedule as if they were sitting in a chair at New Albany High School or sitting in a seat at Floyd Central. But in order for this virtual platform to work, and let me be clear on that, so in order for it to work, you have to have internet access. You have to have the internet access during the school day. In other words, you can't wait till after school to see what happened in class. Although we'll do some recordings of our class periods, but we want students to be attending the class bell schedule from 7:40 to 2:26. So you have to have internet access in order to participate in this program. And as I said, it's kind of what we're duplicating right now. We have probably over 200 viewers streaming in, watching us on a live stream, and then we have about 20 people in this room who are here physically. And the teacher will be able to interact with the students inside the classroom, like I am right now in this boardroom, and also they'll be able to answer questions right then and there from the students who are out in the digital experience. And we'll kind of walk you through what that looks like. The LMS that we use is called Google Classroom. Our goal tonight is to kind of demonstrate that and how you will operate that. We do have videos on our webpage, resources for both parents and students, in order to find out exactly how to navigate it, every aspect, because there's a lot of different components to it, but we're going to show you the basics tonight. High school schedule. As I said, The students that participate in the DSL experience are going to be doing the same bell schedule as if they were attending New Albany or Floyd Central High Schools. Your first period starts at 7:40. You'll have a 5-minute passing period, and you'll be expected to be logged in under your second period class, and we'll show you how to do that. You'll have a 5-minute period, or passing period for to go to third period. Every period, you'll have a 5-minute passing period. Fourth period, you'll have lunch, a 30-minute lunch. The teacher will tell you when your lunch period is, and you'll have lunch at home, and then you'll join your fifth period class when fifth period starts. So we want to make it perfectly clear that it's different than what we did in the spring. And that's why we think it's a lot better product, a lot better educational program than what we offered last year during the spring and the COVID-19 shutdown. Student devices and responsibilities. Let's kind of talk a little bit about what devices students will receive. Students in grades 9 and 10 will receive a Chromebook and charger. Grades 11 and 12 will have the iPads they had last year, and also they receive a charger. All devices belong to New Albany Floyd County School Systems. Okay, they're not your personal device. So if it's damaged or lost at any time, parents or guardians are responsible for that replacement. We also want to note to our parents who are first time, maybe your first time parent with New Albany Floyd County Schools, those of you who've been with us for several years know that we do have a content filter that both monitors traffic inside our district and also outside our district. And we also monitor every student device. I'll say student devices, we don't monitor private devices, but student devices, we're able to see what students are doing with their emails, what they're posting in their Google Drive, drives, and in their Google Classroom. So we're constantly monitoring through our content filter and through our other means to watch that traffic. So some people like to say Big Brother's watching, and yes, we are. We are kind of watching the traffic and what students are doing with their devices. The biggest thing is when you did your registration, parents, you signed an agreement. It's called the acceptable use device policy. Hopefully you read through that, but that was the very first screen you saw in InfoSnap when you did registration. And you clicked that and said you're going to agree to those terms. We also want to be students and parents to be aware that we are not going to allow any attempt to circumvent or disable the filter at any time. And we'll be able to know if you're doing that. As I said, we're able to monitor what the devices are doing. And we're asking parents, if your device is broken, please don't try to repair it yourself. Okay, we have a process in the next slide that kind of talks about that, because if you try to fix the device, you're going to void the warranty. So let us fix the device if something happens to it. So if you're having any type of technology issues with the device, it's not working or it did break on you, you would contact our technology office, and there's the line phone number on the PowerPoint. And they'll quickly respond to you, and they'll ask you to bring your device to the administration building. And if we have to repair the device and keep it overnight, you will be given a temporary replacement. And more times than not, that's usually what we do. You come in, you trade off your device, and you get a new device. So rest assured, you will not go without any time of loss without a device. So if something happens to it, please contact our technology office. At this time, I'm going to stop and pause and see if there's any questions. Dr. Griffin, do we have any questions out there?
Yes, sir. We have quite a few questions coming in. The first one has to do with virtual students taking music electives, band, orchestra, choir, and how that will look.
So there's going to be a slide later on. We talk about lab classes. We refer to those lab classes. So if you're in a marching band program, obviously you can attend marching band practice after school, but probably more than likely in a lab class, those teachers will start with conversation with the students at the beginning, Google Meet, and talk about what they're going to be doing that day. More than likely, you'll be independently rehearsing what they're working on in class. And then at the end of class, they'll touch base with the student and talk about if there's any homework or expectations for the next class period. By all means, there will be some classes, if you signed up for, music keyboarding, which is our piano class, and you do not have a piano at home, we're probably going to ask you to take another elective.
Another question asked, what percentage of students so far have chosen the virtual option?
At this time, we don't have that data, but we do know there is, as I said earlier, when we started the program, there's a lot of angst among parents and students, and we're doing our best to put together a quality educational platform that will meet the need of all our students.
A question asked, if we start virtually, then a few weeks we decide on traditional, and then the virus spikes again, are we able to go back to virtual? They just want to know how much fluidity is involved.
And that's a very difficult question to answer, but I will tell you this. At any time, if you're in the DSL program and you want to return to traditional setting, we welcome you back. As I said earlier, we believe that is probably the best education program we have, is coming to the physical setting of a school and receive your instruction that way. With that being said, at any time you come back and we're in a COVID-19 closure, obviously we'll be doing the virtual program. So it will be fluid, but the one thing I will say, we won't go week by week. One week you're in a traditional setting and you come back, we're not going to allow that. We're going to ask you to give us time to commit to a program, an educational platform, or learning option, and stick with it for a period of time.
How will students be receiving their device?
Okay, I'm going to speak to that. I think that might be the next slide, so we'll get to that one.
Have the students received their virtual schedules yet?
I don't believe they actually have received their schedules yet. I think that will be coming through their high schools. Their principals will be sending that soon.
Okay. How much time do we have to switch from virtual to in-person learning or vice versa?
Well, actually, at any time you want to come back to the physical setting, you can just show up that day at school, call, make an appointment, and we would take you back in.
There's a two-part question here. First is, what will happen if the internet happens to go out? Would that be held against the student?
Obviously, those things do occur, and no, it would not be held against. We have an internet outage, whether it's our fault or their provider's fault.
And then the question asks, how will ROTC look online?
ROTC, obviously, that program does have direct instruction where they learn their standing orders and different aspects of NJROTC. More than likely, ROTC will be like a lab class. The instructor will get on and instruct the students, here's what we're doing today. Then they'll work independently and then come back at the end of class to do some follow-up.
And this one's actually, I think, more for Ms. Faree, talking about setting up case conferences. If I want to set up a case conference with my teacher of record, how would I go about doing that?
I would encourage you to contact them either by phone or email. We're all accessible by email. Also, the secondaries have special education facilitators, so if you're not able to get a response from your teacher of record while teachers are not back in session, then I would encourage you to reach out to your special education facilitator.
Question I think Mr. Wonky's going to answer. Can you please answer how the virtual students would receive their Google Classroom codes?
All right, so let's we'll go to the next couple slides. I think that will answer some of the questions that are coming in. Next slide. So device textbook pickup. Very soon, your high school principals will be posting on their social media, and we'll probably put it in an all call out when the time and date is to pick up their devices. Obviously, school's around the corner, and we'll be getting those devices out fairly quickly. So please check your social media, but I would assume within the next couple days, principals will be communicating to you when that will happen. Here's the key part about that. When you go to pick up your device, there's several things that you're going to receive. You're not just picking up your device to do the virtual learning, the DSL, but also textbooks. Some of our textbooks are online, e-learning books, so you'll be able to activate them through ClassLink, but some of them are physical. So you'll have to pick up those physical textbooks and also class supplies. Some of our classes do have supplies that will be given to you. So you're not just coming to school to pick up your device, but you're also picking up your textbooks or any class supplies associated with that class. In addition, we're going to give you, once again, the acceptable use of device agreement, proper care of your device. We'll give you information on how to care for your device. And the key component here is you don't want to leave school without username and password credentials. That's how you're going to activate your device. So there'll be someone there to assist you, but you will receive information on what your username is and what your password is and how to activate your device in order to get on our network. So make sure you don't leave school without that sheet. In addition, we have Chromebooks and iPads, and we could put together a quick review sheet on how to operate both a Chromebook and an iPad. So make sure when you go to pick up your device, relatively soon our principals will be posting that information, and you want to make sure that you pick up all that information that I just talked about on this slide. Connectivity. Every student in grade 9 and 12, and if you were with us last year, you know you have an email address. And this is a way we communicate with you. Not only do we communicate with you through Google Classroom, the technology department will communicate with you. So constantly, every day, you need to check your student email to see if there's any updates from the technology department. And obviously, we're going to use our email to invite students to class to get their Google Class code. Okay, so that's how, and Mr. Wonky's going to kind of explain that to you. We basically are going to use our LMS as Google Classroom, and we feel very confident with that program. Our high school teachers have been using it for quite some time. Obviously, last year in the spring, we had several teachers, grades 9 to 12, were doing it. But more and more, our high school teachers are becoming very familiar with that program. Students will receive an email from their classroom teacher, and Mr. Walkie is going to explain that to you and how to access each class that you have. Questions? Any questions out there, Dr. Griffin? We think we need to...
Yeah, how would a virtual student go about making a schedule change?
Okay, they would have to go... registration starts the next 2 days at the high school. I would encourage them to go to the registration times at their high school and ask for a schedule change.
Do we know how picture day would work?
Picture day will be communicated by the building principal. They'll probably set up a time when that will take place. More than likely, it will occur after school.
Are we still doing clubs?
Yes, we're still doing clubs at this time.
If a student is homeschooled, will they receive a device from the district if attending Prosser only? So they're a homeschool student that I guess also would attend Prosser.
If a homeschool student is attending more than three of our classes, then yes, they would receive a device.
Okay.
Next slide. Mr. Wonky is going to explain ClassLink, and then we're getting ready to do the demonstration part of our orientation. ClassLink is the where you're going to find all the information you need to know about how to operate through the DSL platform this year. In the ClassLink, you're going to see Google Classroom. You'll find your e-textbooks. You'll see the PowerSchool parent portal. It'll be there eventually. It's not there yet. And also student resources and how to view videotapes on tutorials and how to post assignments in Google Classroom, how to take tests on Google Classroom. The one thing I will tell you about ClassLink on the iPads, the it's an app. You'll see the app on the PowerPoint. On the Chromebooks, you want to go to the home tab, and I think Mr. Wonky is going to explain that. So I think at this point in orientation, I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Wonky, and he's going to kind of demonstrate. And we'll kind of go slow tonight, and we'll stop periodically to ask, see if there's any questions out there.
Thank you, Dr. Jensen. Again, to highlight for students with iPads, as 11th and 12th grade students, they will have an app on their iPad. It's going to look exactly like this. They'll click that, and they will be logged in directly into ClassLink by selecting that app. That app is going to be located in the bottom bar of their iPad, and so it will always be visible to those students. For students on the Chromebook, this is where I'm going to exit out of our PowerPoint slide presentation and show what it's going to be like for them in order to access ClassLink. The first thing to mention is on that student-provided Chromebook, as soon as students log into the device, they open it up and they enter in their username and password, they will actually be taken directly to ClassLink. That's the first thing that's going to populate for them. As well, though, if they are anywhere else on that Chromebook and they have navigated away from ClassLink and need to navigate back to ClassLink, all they simply need to do is, within Google Chrome, open a tab and select the home button. And just to highlight here, we're talking about this button right here in the top left-hand corner of their screen. When I select that home button, I am taken directly to ClassLink and I'm logged directly in. On our student Chromebooks, when they log in initially, when they open their screen and they log in, they're logged into everything from that point. And they're logged in directly to ClassLink, and they have access here to all of these applications, which may or may not be used by your student. That depends on the coursework, but absolutely Google Classroom will be used by all students and all teachers. And so we're going to navigate there. We're going to select on and click here Google Classroom. And when I do that, I'm taken directly to my Google Classroom. And tonight here, for purposes of our demonstration, I am logged in as a student, so this is the same exact screen that your students are going to see when they log in terms of Google Classroom and having classes. Let me step back one small step there to mention that they will have to add their classes. I apologize, I overstepped there, but I will highlight that first, and then we're going to go in and talk about our Google Meet session and how to work through those. But as Dr. Jensen mentioned, I am going to join my classes. I'm expected as a student to join my classes, and I'm going to receive an email from my teachers with my Google Class code. And so I'm going to come up here to the top right-hand corner with that plus button. And when I click on that plus button, I have the opportunity to enter a class code. So I will receive through email 7 class codes. I will need to come into Google Classroom. I will need to select that plus button and enter in 7 separate codes. Those codes are individual to the class. No other class has that code. It is always 7 characters that are lowercase or numbers. For that code, there's no uppercase, there's no special characters. So I would come to Google Classroom, I'd have my codes, I'd enter them one at a time. As I enter them and I select join, down here in the bottom right hand corner, I will be entered into that class. Now to take a moment to talk about utilizing Google Meet as a part of your synchronized learning environment. I'm going to go into my first period class. So as Dr. Jensen mentioned, 7:40, bells rung at school. I'm ready to begin my school day as well at home, and so I will come to my first period class, and I will click on that class, and then right here in the top left-hand corner of my class screen, I have a Google Meet link, and that is how I am going to receive my synchronous learning, is through that Google Meet session. And so all I will need to do as a student is come into my class and select that Meet link, and so I'm going to do that right now. And I'm purposefully going to highlight that I cannot join or create a meeting as a student. In order for that link to work, the teacher must first activate that link on their end. That allows us to always have monitored digital learning spaces from our teachers, and that students can't be on there with simply another student without being monitored. So I'm going to come and I am going to start that meeting as a teacher, or as the teacher here in this situation. And I will now come back to my meeting here as the student and click that Google Meet link. And when I do that, I am going to see myself. I kind of have a doorway here, if you will, before I actually walk into that digital classroom. And I'm presented with the options here of muting myself, both my microphone and my camera, in order to mute my camera. We are asking that all students, when they join a class, they do mute their microphone and leave their camera on. And then you'll see that you will not be in this class until you select join now. And so I'm going to go ahead and do that and show myself in here on this video setting. You're not necessarily seeing anything now, but as the student, I would be seeing it. I can pull it up here. You would be seeing the teacher talk. And so I'm actually, I have my class running as the teacher on another device. I'm here on my student device and I am seeing myself, but of course our students will be seeing their teachers. Highlight again real quick, we have those buttons and icons in order to unmute yourself as well as to mute the camera if for some reason there's a need to do that. But if I have a question, the expectation for students is that they will unmute that microphone and they will ask their questions as they have them within class. There's a second option to ask questions and to communicate to the teacher, and that is through the chat available within Google Meet. This chat icon is in the top right hand corner. And when I select that, I will receive a chat log and I can type in any question that I have. Can you please repeat that? I can type that in. The teacher's going to receive it on there and be able to see that and answer any questions that may develop there. I also want to take a moment to highlight an important accessibility feature directly built into Google Meet, and that is closed captioning. And so closed captioning is down here in the bottom right-hand corner of our screen. This, an important note is that this is an individual setting, meaning I as the student have to turn this on. my teacher cannot turn this on for me. But what happens when I turn this on is, as I'm beginning to talk here, and I'm going to turn on my microphone as the teacher, it is going... Come on. Apologies. It is going to start... Let me pull that away. It's going to start showing exactly the words that I am speaking as I speak them. This is part of Google's artificial intelligence technology, to be honest, and it is rather slick and quick in terms of what it can do, because it is accurate, it is fast, and it will provide for your students at home the ability to read what is being said in the classroom. Again, highlighting this is an individual setting. I have to come in and do this as a student. My teacher cannot do this for me, but I can turn it on or off at any time.
So, Mr. Wonky, just to kind of clarify some things, each period your son or daughter is enrolled in a class, that's how they're going to access their Google Meet in order to get the DSL, the virtual digital synchrony stream into their device. A couple clarifying questions or a couple of things we like to point out. Our teachers will be wearing mics, and we have an audio enhancement center, audio enhancement devices in our middle school. In essence, they will hear the teacher very clearly in class. So even though the teacher will be moving around in the class and doing some direct instruction, it will be piped into the device, and the students in the virtual setting will hear clearly. And we want students to participate in the class. We want them to ask questions where they mute their mic or they put it in the chat room, because the teacher knows that they have to come back and check with those students who are in the virtual experience. The students who are in the virtual experience will not see the classroom itself. The classroom camera will either be pointed at the teacher all times or be in presentation mode. And what we mean by presentation mode, it will be either focused on a smart board presentation or some type of PowerPoint, and they will not be able to see the actual students in the class. Okay, that's kind of the guidance we're giving our teachers. But at any time, they can ask a question, and this teacher will interact with them, and they should hear clearly the teacher's instructions and directions. And sometimes during the class period, the teacher will say, I'm going to work independently now. Students are going to ask students to work independently. So they may put the mic on mute themselves, and students will work independently in class, and then they'll come back and ask for clarifying questions. So periodically, the teacher may do that. So those are kind of how that works. So Dr. Griffin, do we have any questions about Google Meet?
Yes, sir. So. Question says, once students receive their schedule in the mail, will this be their virtual schedule as well? So will they have those same teachers in a live stream format? And if they move to traditional, will they keep the same teachers?
And that's a great question. And yes, that will be their teachers in the virtual setting. And if they move to a physical setting, come back to the traditional classroom, they'll have the same teachers. That's correct.
Would students have flexibility if they are home ill to go ahead and join via live streaming, even though they're technically a traditional student?
Traditional students who are home ill, especially if you're under a COVID-19 and you're asked to be quarantined, but yes, in those cases they would be. But if student is home ill and they don't feel well, then it's not an expectation that day they do come in. But knowing that students will be doing the virtual experience, and that I don't see why they couldn't come in and view that classroom. But that would be an expectation of a kid who's homesick for one day.
Will the private chat feature be turned off during Meet sessions?
I believe that is correct, is how we're going to set it up.
Will the virtual students be able to see the students that are in the class physically?
Not in the class physically. As I said, the camera is always going to be pointed toward the teacher or to a presentation in the classroom. And that's not to be said that at some time the teacher moves their device and they see kids in the classroom, but more than likely they'll never see a student in the physical classroom.
Gotcha.
Okay. Let's go to Google Classroom.
Real quick, I will mention there is an expectation of students at the end of a class period, and that is to leave the class. Again, this is an effort to ensure that we do not have unmonitored students in our virtual learning environments. And so all a student needs to do at the end of the class period is simply leave the call with that red phone icon in the bottom middle of their screen. And so when I do that, I will have left the class. I can, again, not join that class back again until that teacher has opened that class. But to highlight some items around this Google Classroom. And again, what we are certainly, what I've been sharing with teachers is this is our students' digital learning space. We have our physical classrooms of the learning environment. Here is our digital learning environment. And so the items that we have access to and can see here, first of all, are the stream, the classwork, and the people. And so at the top center of our screen here is where I'm seeing the stream, our classwork, and our people. And the stream is going to be used for teachers to communicate announcement information. This is very simple, straightforward, something that the teacher wants the students to know. So this could be as simple as reminder, test on Friday. And so teachers will post that information there, and students can come in at any time. This does not have to be during class time. They can come in at any time and consume that information. The classwork page is where students are going to find their classwork for the class. So this is where content and assignments are going to be posted for students. And we have a couple of examples here, starting with a class syllabus. So certainly teacher may be providing class materials to all of their students. That materials could be a number of different things, starting with, as our example here, this class syllabus. In order for me to view this as a student, I simply select class syllabus there and I click on this document here. It's showing me that this is as a Google Doc. I can select that class syllabus. It will open in a new tab for me, and I can read through my syllabus that my teacher has provided me. As well, teachers have been instructed and have here some organizational aspects of topics. And so we see here I have a chapter one topic, and then I have assignments within this chapter one topic. And so teachers will set up their classes differently here depending on their content. But teachers do have this opportunity, and they will provide instructions and make sure students are aware, you know, hey, this is where we're at. We're on chapter one right now, and your work is here. And so when I come in here and I look here at this chapter one reading assignment, this is something that I as a student am expected to do, assigned by my teacher. I see here in the top right-hand corner, when I've selected on that, this is an assignment. I have here read chapter one, from the provided novel and answer the questions on the Google Doc and turn in with Google Classroom. So all within this system, we have the ability to assign work to students and for that student to turn that work back into the teacher. So as I'm the student and I select on my document here for this assignment, I will see here the teacher has provided me a list of questions based off of this assignment. I come in as the student and I provide my responses, whatever this may be. Please excuse the nothingness that is typed in, but I provide my responses, and then the top right hand corner I have a one click button to turn this assignment back in to the teacher. And so I select my turn in, and I receive a message here asking me double check, am I ready to turn in my work? Here's what I am turning in. I select turn in, and I've completed that work for that assignment. Also, I want to highlight for each class within the classwork tab, I have a few icons up here at the top. I will highlight the view your work icon. So a very quick and easy way for students to one click away from going to see the work that they have currently expected of them. And so when I select that view your work, I'm going to see here everything that I need to do as a part of this class. As well, I skipped over the people tab, but I'll come back to this at this point, and that is to highlight how I can email my teacher. So when I select this people tab, all I'm gonna see here is teachers. I see myself, I am my own teacher in this scenario, but I simply select that email icon and I will be able to email my teacher directly in order to communicate with them. And so that will display. I can send out my email with my questions, whatever I may have. And we do have one other capability to interact and communicate with our teachers, and that is through posting comments within items on the class stream. So I'll see here, this is an item that was shown on my class stream. When I click on this as a student, I get here class comments, and I have the ability to comment and pose a question to the entire class as well as to the teacher. And then I also have here on the right-hand side the ability to post a private comment just directly to the teacher. So again, multiple ways for our students at home to communicate with their teachers in the classroom, both openly and privately.
So to kind of, we can take questions here in a moment, Dr. Griffin. The Google Classroom, the LMS, the Learning Management System, is a little bit different than our student information system. You know, most of you are probably aware that we're moving to PowerSchool. Parents have a parent portal in PowerSchool. They have their own credentials, and they can go on and see their students' attendance and their grades and their discipline actions. The only way you're going to be able to view your son or daughter's Google Classroom is to log in with their credentials. So your son or daughter is going to have to share that. So if you want to go in and look to see what your son or daughter is doing in Google Classroom as far as posting assignments, making sure they're keeping up to date, your son or daughter is going to have to share that information with you. Questions, Dr. Griffin?
Yeah, we talked a little bit about homework. Somebody asked, will kids be assigned homework? I think we answered that. And then how to post those assignments. I think Mr. Monkey just answered that as well. There's one student who still has their device from summer school. Do they need to return the device to have any updates made on it, or can they keep that device, or what should they do there?
Great question. And we understood that students who participate in summer school, we're going to ask them to keep their devices. They don't have to turn that in.
Will virtual students be able to access these classes later in case they miss something or they would like to review the class?
So you're talking about recording the classroom. We're having conversations about how that plays out. Some of our teachers will record their direct teaching. So yes, there will be times when they can go back in and see that.
Okay.
Let's go back to the PowerPoint then. Let's talk a little bit about, and Mr. Wonky did a nice job talking expectations, and I just want to reaffirm them. Once again, the learning platform this fall is totally different than what we had in the spring. The expectation is every day, students go online and attend every class. We're taking attendance every period. So teachers are going to be posting attendance in PowerSchool of students who are present and who are not. So you won't be able to sit home and think, I'm going to get online maybe at noon to see what's in Google Classroom. You're expected to follow the bell schedule that's present at New Albany High School or at Floyd Central. Cameras always turned on. We want students, when they come into the Google Meet, to mute your mic, and then we want your camera turned on. We want you to communicate with your teacher. In fact, we're asking our teachers to communicate with the students who are participating in the DSL platform. So they're probably going to touch base with you at the beginning of class to see where you're at, if you have any questions. Then probably at the end of class, they're going to draw closure with you to see if you have any questions. But at any time, you can unmute your mic and ask the question orally. The teacher will hear it. The students in the class will hear it. Or you can do a chat. Simply send a chat. Complete all your assignments. Just because you're participating in our DSL program, we want everyone to participate all assignments posted in Google Classroom. Let's talk a little bit about Prosser and lab classes. I want to first start with Prosser. A student can attend New Albany or Floyd Central High School virtually and then go to Prosser to attend in a physical setting. In fact, we encourage you, if you're going to do the DSL platform, that you attend Prosser in the physical sense. Because Prosser has dual credits related to seat time and certification that require you to complete labs in a physical setting. Now, with that being said, that doesn't mean you can't attend Prosser virtually, but you're going to put those dual credits and those certifications at risk. Some programs like computer programming at Prosser, you can do virtually with no problem at all. But then when you get into the heavy equipment program, culinary arts program, those programs are going to require lab experiences. So I believe Mr. Taylor, the director of our Prosser program, has even emailed and sent out news information about expectations of students. Students who are participating in a virtual setting will be asked to come in and probably at least two times a week to do some type of lab with the class. That's optional. We can't require you to do that, but we really encourage you to come in and do the labs in a physical setting in order to get the dual credits and the certifications. So lab classes, I kind of had fielded a question earlier about that. This teacher, whether it's a visual arts class, radio and TV, ROTC, theater, the teacher will probably start off having a conversation with the students in the virtual setting to see if there's anything. Probably will give direct instruction for a while. You can participate in the lecture or direct teaching, and then ask the students to work independently. And then at the end, they'll probably bring the students back before the end of the bell of that class period and say, is there any questions you have for me before you go on to your next class? So that's how we envision classes that have labs, what we refer to as a lab setting. Questions on that fielding?
A question came up with regards to having multiple kids at home learning virtually. Is there headset options? Are there headset options for the Chromebooks or iPads?
Yes, you can absolutely plug in a set of headphones, a set of earbuds. We do recommend that, and that allows the student to be able to hear the teacher that much more clearly. That is not something we'll be providing?
No, we will not be providing it.
Right. Okay. But we do encourage it, and we do recommend it. Again, it's for the student's sake of being able to hear that teacher much more clearly.
Question came up with regards to taking tests virtually versus traditionally.
Right. So we do have a program known as Bloxy that allows us to control the device. When students are taking a test, their device will be locked down, and we'll only be able to take the test.
What will happen when a student has a study hall?
When they have a study hall, we're going to expect them to report to the study hall, and probably those log in, and the study hall teacher will see that they're present and mark them in attendance. As far as interaction with the study hall teacher, that will be up to the student and the teacher in charge of the study hall. Some of our schools, I think both schools, I believe New Albany and Floyd Central, have mentoring study halls or basic skill classes. So there will be an expectation in those classes if students are assigned there.
May a student use a personal device to attend class virtually, or must they use the school-issued device?
We prefer the school-issued device because we're able to monitor their activity. If they use their own personal device, they obviously can join, but we won't be able to monitor.
So if a student begins school traditionally but feels really anxious about that, may they switch to virtual quickly?
Basically, that would probably be within a time frame of a day to 2 days. They would go to their counselor and say, I would like to go virtually. Obviously, the counselor is going to contact the parent to make sure that's what they want to do. And then we would set up getting them a device. Well, they have their device. So realistically, that's probably going to be able to do in a one-day period, time period.
Is there going to be an opportunity for an orientation like this for traditional students and families?
So each building has their own orientation they do with all new students coming in. So I would say that's going to probably happen relatively soon if they have not reached out to you through social media, through email. With that being said, every teacher will go over the expectations of Google Classroom because it's going to be an expectation whether you're in the traditional setting or you're doing the DSL learning platform, you will have to have access to Google Classroom because we don't know at any time when we're going to a COVID-19 closure like we did last spring. Hopefully that doesn't happen, but if it does, we'll be prepared to go into the same DSL learning environment that our virtual students are. So if for some reason we are closed for a long period of time, we're not going to repeat the e-learning platform we had last year. So it's totally different. You'll be expected. If we are closed, whether you're in virtual or physical setting, you're going online 7:40 for first period and then 8:25 or 8:26 for your second period. You're going to follow that bell schedule just as if you were present in class.
So my student prefers to use his desktop computer over the iPad because of the larger work area. However, there's no webcam. Is that a problem?
That's something we'll have to work through. Obviously, we will be able to see that they're online. We just will not see them personally.
My incoming freshman will be a virtual student but would like to come to the freshman orientation. Is that okay?
Yes, we encourage you, if you're participating virtually, you are invited to the freshman orientation. We want you to be, you actually have the same rights as a student attending in a physical setting. So all the activities that occur at school after hours, we encourage you to participate. If you want to go to a ball game, volleyball, football, we ask you to participate in the high school experience.
This one I'm not sure if we have the answer to, but I'll read it. Please advise what the outlook is for our sports teams, wrestling in particular.
I really can't tell you at this point. Obviously, we are starting our sports program. We started 3 weeks ago, and we anticipate on August 3rd that our fall sports will be to a normal practice schedule. So we're anticipating that we will have sports.
Quick question for Ms. Faree, I believe. How will the testing be done for online students with an IEP due to extra times and things the student may need while taking a test or quiz?
We've had this discussion within our shop and with the special education facilitators, and so we anticipate that we will have to set up separate testing environments or separate Google Classroom environments so students may have tests read to them, have extra time, or have the accommodations that they need within the IEP. So you'll have to be patient with us. We've not done this before, but we certainly understand that we will need to provide the accommodations, and we're having ongoing discussions about how to do that virtually, but we will certainly get it done.
The connectivity question with regards to a district this size, are we confident in the connectivity on our end?
Yes. And we increased that over the summer. Yes, definitely confident. Let's kind of talk about parent communication with teacher. Just like if your son or daughter was attending school physically, you can communicate with your student's teacher through email or through calling on the phone and leaving a voice message. Soon you will receive information, probably mid-August, about PAR School Parent Portal. It's just like our iNow Parent Portal in the past. You'll receive credentials that you can go online and monitor your son or daughter's attendance and their grades. That communication we anticipate to be sent out probably the third week in August, sometime at that point. Let's go back to the district webpage, Mr. Wonky, because we want to point this out again. We've created a tab on our district webpage that is identified as DSL Virtual E-Learning Resources. As time goes on, we will populate that with a lot of different resources. This orientation that was recorded tonight, we're going to post this orientation on there. Tomorrow night, when we do the middle school and elementary orientation, we will post that. But that will have a vast wealth of resources, and we really encourage parents to kind of constantly look at that in order to get your questions answered. I think we're kind of done with the PowerPoint. Dr. Griffin, do we have any more questions?
Let's see here. Question about traditional with regards to passing periods and things like that, safeguards in place to try to keep social distancing.
Well, I think everyone's fully aware that there is a mask requirement in our school district, so we expect our students, when they're in the hallways, to travel on the right side of the hallway and keep that social distance and have their mask on. I think we're going to probably about done with the orientation tonight, and we appreciate those people who streamed in live and asked questions. I want to reach out and thank Mr. Hamby and Mr. Wesley, our tech team, who did a nice job putting this together. Mr. Wonky, outstanding. He's been doing a great job training our teachers. So we feel pretty confident getting ready to start the school year. We'll be able to deliver that DSL. Ms. Faree, thank you for your participation. Dr. Griffin, thank you for reading the questions. So to kind of wrap this up, very soon our principals will be reaching out to you. We do have your email address. If you've registered, make sure you register. If you haven't registered, we won't have your email address. And they will be communicating about when device pickup is. And make sure you check your email, parents, also social media. All that information will be coming very, very soon. So we encourage you to check that out. And when you go to school, make sure you pick up all the information that we kind of shared with you tonight. With that, I'm going to close with, it's going to be a very interesting year. In New Albany, Floyd County, we like to think that we always rise to the challenge. We believe the program we put together for our DSL students, that we will be meeting the expectations that you believe that happen in a traditional setting. With that, good night. Thank you very much.